So, hi brothers, we saw in the last classes about God's revelation as a communitarian experience of the people, and the example was of the Exodus event. Looking back on the Exodus event, people realized that God was active in the history of their liberation. This is a God experience of the people. So that is one specific thing we have to underline. Most often or usually, God experience is God experience for the people. Revelation is also in this way an experience for the people. Revelation by God to an individual about any particular truth, that is excluded from our understanding of revelation. God never reveals any truths to any person, that we must be clear. God does not break the laws of nature to show his involvement in the nature. I told you, they gave the example of lifting this cup of water and keeping it here. Any amount of prayer, any amount of request, God is not going to do that. Whatever you pray, it will remain. The laws of gravity, it cannot be broken, it cannot raise by itself. And God simply will not break the law of gravity to place the cup here. If God wants to help someone with a cup of water or with anything, what he does is, without changing the order of nature, changing the transcendent world and the immanent world, that difference, without breaking that difference, he makes a person in historical level to go and do the necessary things. Very often there are people who confess that at that time he came and helped me. God himself came and helped me, right? That is what happens. God helps in every situation through the intermediary of someone in history. In the case of Exodus, the intermediary was Moses and Aaron. So there is no miracle of this type where God breaks the law of nature. It is not because it goes against the modern science we are saying this. Supposing God breaks the law of nature and allows this cup of water to come and place itself here, God becomes part of our everyday world of tangibility. God is never reduced to the world at hand, the world which I can take hold of. Natural law, breaking of the natural law would mean that God becomes part of the historical events as an ordinary actor. God is not an ordinary actor. God is never to be found like one of the persons who are sitting here. God is not that. God is not in this way a thing among things, not one of you. And I told you yesterday, it is a little funny when people thank God Almighty at the end of a program for the meeting, successfully conducted a meeting.
Then what about Jesus? He is like a person.
He is a historical person. Now he is not in history. Jesus is a historical person, but now he is not in history. He is now the risen one. And so even he will not enter and make this cup of water to break the law of gravity and place itself here. He would not do that. If he wants, or God wants to do anything, he does it through the intermediary of someone who is in our historical world. The transcendental world is not broken, and the historical world does not become God's area of direct involvement. Actually, the so-called two worlds, there are no two worlds, supernatural and natural. Natural world and supernatural world, there is no breaking of one world into the other. Everything is natural and supernatural. Anything that we do is by the power of God. So you can say, if I lift this cup of water and play here, you can say, it is with God I did it. God enabled me to do that. God enabled me, gave me the strength. God gave me the eyes. God gave me the perception. And God gave me the capability of doing it. God did that. We can say in this way. But God never becomes part of our tangible world. If God becomes that way, God becomes part of God becomes part of our tangible world, and God is not anything more than a human being. And God is not a human being. God is not a thing among things. God is not to be spoken of like a table here. And so I said also, the language of metaphysics and the common language, common perception, common knowledge, common understanding, that language cannot be strictly used about God. You cannot say God is there in the strict sense, because the word is has a different meaning when we say God is. So this distinction you must keep in mind. And another distinction with regard to God's revelation is, God never reveals any empirical truths. The addition of a series of numbers, like Shakuntala Devi was able to do, big series of numbers she was able to calculate and total and everything, that is not God's revelation. God does not tell her. She has used her human capacity to do that. What is the human capacity, limit of human capacity? We do not know. We normally use only 5% or 10% of the total human capacity. She has developed an ability to use another 30% or 40% of the human capacity, and she is able to, as the scientists say, see the digits, letter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. She does not see it as we human beings see it, but she sees it in terms of color. So it's called synesthesia. It's called synesthesia in terms of color, and then she makes out all these and adds and subtracts, and so not as we do, but with the help of this new kind of perception which she has. It is on the human level, it is possible. Even now there are people who see letters in terms of color, letters in a different way than we, and then the calculation is easy, totally different. That is explained by psychology, explained by scientists. But then she was a very expert person. But so though, we should not think that a thing looks very much ununderstandable, unexplainable for us. There we need not put God there to explain. So we are putting God, plugging the black hole with God. That is not true. God is not a means to plug the black holes of ignorance. That we should not do. I do not know the physical law, the natural law behind it. After some years, it may be revealed. For our ancestors, many of the things that we now do are simply miracles, unexplainable. For people who lived 100 years ago, you speak of what you say that I speak to a small little thing here, and another man 1,000 kilometers away, other part of the world, he listens what I am speaking. He will surely find it as a miracle, but today it is a normal thing. Our cell phones. At that time, supposing somebody had done that way, people would normally have put it as God's action. That kind of understanding God's action is wrong. The understanding of the physical law was not there at that time. Plug it with the God. That is not correct. Even today, many of the things which we do not know, we should not take God as the reason, because we did not know the real reason. Natural laws have got natural explanations. We must leave it at that. God should not be made into apart from the totality of the things that are here. God is the condition for the possibility of anything. Condition for the possibility of things. So new human knowledge. Anything. Am I talking here? The condition for my possibility of talking to you is the divine. He is not part of this order, this natural order. He is behind. So God should not be made to function here. You understand? The supernatural, natural order, two orders in that way. Supernatural order, things at that particular level. Under that, there is a natural order. So God breaks the supernatural order and comes into the natural order and does things against the natural order, natural law. That is never so. That should not be attributed to God. That is a misunderstanding of the meaning of miracle. Miracle is totally God's working. Totally God is responsible. If you look at it that way, anything that we do, the condition for the possibility is God. God is enabling me to do. In that way, God is the miracle doer. Everything in the world, everything in history is in that way possible because of God. And so I can say everything is a miracle, like a plant coming up, this building not falling down, and by killing all of you. It can fall, no? It doesn't kill, it doesn't happen. Nobody thinks of it as a miracle. So, in many ways, things are there like that, which we should not bring down God into the natural order of things. Natural order is historical level where human beings and the things are active. God is not part of not a thing among things. That is the shortest form to remember. God is not a thing among things. Heidegger has brought it in a very clear philosophical explanation. The being is not a thing among things. Beings, they are things. So, I am having to repeat these narrations, repeat this insight, and repeat this example number of times before you, because the old conception from your mind does not go away very easily. That God does change the natural law. That takes time. I may require to say this again in different ways. What you should keep in mind is this: God is not a thing among things. It's not like He cannot be my assistant. God is taking care of the climate, and I am organizing the seminar, and I thank God everything went well. Today it was cloudy, but still it did not rain. I thank God Almighty for that. Let us all clap together. That is funny. You are reducing God into one of the elements here, one of the workers who helped me, and God is not such a worker at all. I am God's servant. So I must respect Him as not a worker under me. Not only that, you are in the image of God's likeness. There is the divine present in you all. So when I thank you, when I thank my assistants, when I thank the other brothers who helped me, I'm thanking God Himself. God is not separate and away from those human beings. And God, if God wants to do something and help me, He helps it through the people, through those persons. And God has helped to conduct the seminar very well. In the same way, I should be able to say, God helped me to get up in the morning. God helped me to walk. God helped me to breathe. God helped me to take breakfast. We don't say all that, no? We can say that. In that sense, God does everything. So God is the source of everything. God is the ultimate explanation for anything that takes place. But ordinary things we don't attribute to God. So let us not make the mistake of conducting a seminar as God's particular help for keeping away the clouds for the 2 hours time. And thank God. I thank God Almighty and clap hands. You see the funniosity of that, no? Instead of that, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. What am I doing by that? I am thanking God. You are God's face. You are God's likeness. You are an image of God, image and likeness of God. Let me take that into serious consideration. Then everything is done by God. And when I thank you, I am thanking God. There is no separate thanking, as if one number one for God, number two for human beings. So that must be clear. I drank this water. God gave me this water, brought me this water. I need water. I can't take class without it. God gave me this. But I don't thank God for that, but I thank Shekhar or Josmar. Through Josmar, I am thanking God. That is a sensible way of doing things. So, otherwise, God becomes a promoter of inauthenticity. Loudy. Ordinary man cannot accept what? Right. I understand. Ordinary human understanding is not able to grasp this. So, what does it mean? I should continue speaking in the ordinary man's language? Or should I speak a more biblically true language? If the ordinary man is not able to understand that the sun is not going around the earth. Earth is going around the sun. Which language should I speak? When you speak to the ordinary man, you say, sun is here, sun was on the top there, sun was on the left, here, sun was here, when did it happen? Sun was there. Ordinary, you took the ordinary man in the ordinary language. But the true language of truth is sun did not move. So we should never use the language of science and truth. It does not show. To some people, we may have to use this ordinary man's language. But ordinary man's language is temporary or for the time being to be used. So we can use ordinary man's language, but then make him enlightened to understand that God is everywhere and God does everything. God is the condition for the possibility of anything. Without God, nothing. If God were not here, I would not be here. God is the condition for my possibility of standing, being, talking, everything. God is the ground of my being, I said the other day. If ground is not there, will I be able to stand here? Ground is there, God is the ground of being. So my being in the world can be explained only by God. But that doesn't become a miracle because I am every day here and nobody thinks of it as something extraordinary and wonderful. It's a normal thing. Therefore, we don't think of it as related to God. These things are related to God. Connect these events to God, then that is your deep contemplation, meditation. Tell the ordinary man to think in this way and teach them that God is there behind everything. And when he is able to accept in the ordinary things God is there, then he has got a deeper perception of God. He thinks nowhere God is not here, he's only human beings. And God comes only when I pray. And so when I pray, miracle takes place. That is a false understanding of God. It is very difficult to remove it from the mind of people who think like that. Very difficult. And that's why I told you, teaching this is difficult. Because your concepts will not go away from your mind easily. You must try hard to get this perception. What I told is something which you can agree. That if one is, there are no two orders, supernatural and natural. Supernatural and natural order was posited by St. Thomas Aquinas for explaining things of the divine nature in a particular context of language, language of things. At that time, the language of things was used, and whatever he said, whatever we could formulate in a sentence about a thing, that is there. Today we know our knowledge is much limited. We cannot know things in themselves. We do not know things in themselves. Let us be humble enough to accept that. In the background of that, what we know is what is working in my conscience. The objective reality, they are there. But I do not know what really it is, philosophically speaking. But the reality is there. The reality works upon me, has an impact on me, and my subjectivity comprehends the reality. And therefore, the reality that I know is connected with my subjectivity. There is nothing that is totally objective where my subjectivity does not come in, where my capacity to understand things, where my capacity to see things through a white glass comes in. If it is where my eyes were blue, I would see all things as blue. That is my natural way of thinking. I would not know that things are not blue, but they are in this way, different things in different colors. If I had only blue, my eyes were blue. How can I know? So this is a thing that you must be able to understand. I suppose you can accept what I am saying. But then the full consequence of what I am saying is difficult for you to grasp. I know that. And therefore you are asking so many questions. I encourage you to ask questions every time, but then I am repeating myself. So you think Father is saying everything the same thing. You are forcing me to the same thing. So number of times you hear and then you begin to understand. Slowly, you will begin to understand.
But when we speak to the believers, they say that we are heresy. Means when we say these things, how can they say?
Yeah. Heresy means what? Wrong teaching. So we are not giving a wrong teaching. They are speaking the geocentric language. But the truth is heliocentric. Two different ways of looking at things, two different ways of grasping. So heliocentric understanding of things is not a heresy. But a way of talking which he does not know. So this doesn't seem to be in any way heresy. I am not teaching heresy, be sure. But the old pre-Vatican metaphysical language being used for God, that should not be done. I am conscious of that. I am trying to make you conscious of it so that you are able to interpret things more correctly. Any other question? Good. So that is something which we saw the other day. The truths of the natural world God never reveals by a revelation. So nobody should say, God has told me that there in that corner there is some gold treasure. The treasure is there. God has told me. Nobody should say that. If you have got the human capacity and 90% you have, of which we don't normally use, and you are using 88% of that, and you come to know somehow, I do not know, I may not be able to explain it. But just because I do not explain it, does not mean that God should be put in that place of explanation. You must search for explanation and find out. That is doing justice to God. We must do justice to God also. God does justice to us. But then this shifting of language from geocentric to heliocentric, that is an experience you have to go through. That is an experience you have to make clear to the people. Is that okay? So, God should not become part of the totality of our world, should not be graspable, tangible things, something at hand. God is not that kind of a reality which I can just fall upon for explaining things which I do not know how things are working. God in that case would become promoter of inauthenticity. Inauthenticity means falsehood. God is promoting falsehood. And don't make God to promote falsehood. If God were promoting the understanding of geocentric worldview and telling that it is everything in that language, that God would be promoting inauthenticity. God would be encouraging inaccurate understanding of things. God would be blamed of not allowing people to go deep into reality of things and understand. God should be understood as the foundation for the possibility of everything. And so when I get a deeper understanding of things, it is God who invites me to that. If I understand the heliocentric understanding of the world, it is God who enables me that. There is nothing against God in understanding earthing as different from ordinary common man's understanding. And science requires that. So I'm repeating it for the 100th time. Then, God involved in history, we have said. How is that? God involved in history to save the Jews, Exodus. That takes place all through history. Wherever there is a movement of people away from slavery towards greater freedom, God is active there in history, but not as a historical person, not as a historical reality, not as a thing among things, not as one of us. But then he is the condition for the possibility of this movement towards freedom. He is the one who enables that. He is behind everything. In that sense, any movement today, in the style and format of Exodus event, any movement towards freedom, God is behind. A Dalit movement, for example, to assert their rights and human dignity, they have to struggle so much. They have to make dharnas and make petitions and so on. That movement is going on. Dalit movement is going on. God is behind it. God is to be identified with the Dalits moving towards their greater freedom. Just like in the case of the Exodus. So that is where you have to see. And so God is involved in history in this way, through mediation of movements, persons, and so on. And everything in the world is attributable to God's knowledge and so on. And so when we take a historical movement of the Dalits, for example, as moving towards freedom, and after 100 years, I'm looking back and saying, Dalits were in such a big suffering. There was no equality there, no respect of human beings and so on there. But then they have been now brought to a state of equality. Imagine, they are equal to everyone. There is no more caste system in the world. And everybody is respected as individuals. Everyone is respected, not the white man and not the high class Brahmin alone, not the bishops alone being respected, not the priests alone being respected. Priests are being respected very highly, you know. Not priests alone, smallest man so-called belonging to the caste, he is also equally respected like anybody else as a human being. So at that time I look back and say, my God, 100 years ago it was not like that. And they moved to this situation, God was there with them. And this is a God experience for the people. Their movement from slavery to freedom of today, supposing after 100 years, if I were to say that, God is behind it. God is the one who enables everything. God is the condition for the ability. So God enables all the movements. So that way we have to see God in all the movements towards freedom. The other day, that advocate, Prashant Bhushan, in his name, there was a big movement all over India, people protesting against that. There is God in that. It is a demand for greater justice and freedom, and it is a demand for greater democracy in India. And that is part of God's promise of milk and honey. Milk and honey means, you know, fullness of life, godly divine life. So this is part of that. And we should have been involved in that as people representing God's involvement in the world, as priests. And that's why I told you, if there is a movement like that, we should not think of them as secular movement and nothing we have to do with them. That we should not think. We should know God is active and take part in that. Be with God. We have to be with God. You can choose not to be with God. Invitation from God is coming to you. Invitation you can accept or deny. So better to be a man related to God by accepting God's invitation through these. Yes. That is always in the history. There is always this dialectics, opposing one thing with the other. In this opposition of now the powerful judges and the powerful people of society, including Modi, has all the laws according to his liking. They interpret everything. So we can say the powerful, including the executive and the judiciary, are now maintaining one thing. The poor, the ordinary, oppressed, they are denied the right. There is this conflict. The powerful against the oppressed. Wherever the oppression is overcome, wherever the demands of the oppressed are given right, their God is active. There, not in the oppressors. Just like in the, so the model is the Exodus event. God is active on the side of the oppressed Jews. So today it is the oppressed Indians. The other people want to oppress. And so any movement against this oppression is God's activity in history. God is involving, God is promoting. In such a 3 days' time, such a thing, so many lakhs of people send their protest to the judiciary. Just imagine, 3 days, lakhs of people. Is not God behind it? Well, that kind of things, God is behind. So that is to be understood. So we speak of revelation. Revelation is never objective kind of knowledge. Okay. Now we continue with what we had said earlier, little more. Any event in history, when it is a revelation of God, takes on a mythical character. Any historical event, a myth event of history, and that is not to be considered as a negative negative thing. On the contrary, some element of mythical modification is necessary to understand the past, or that is the way we humanity understands things. So we cannot try and do demythologization of everything, demythologize and have faith. Demythologize to understand the historical core of it. Then we come back to the scripture account of it, as it is mythologized. We know it is mythologized. But then we have both. We cannot do away with mythologization. By doing that, we refuse to understand the divine intervention. Then I said also, revelation is an event. An event that takes place in me. Not an objective event outside, simply there. That is not revelation. It becomes revelation when it takes place as an event in me. So Geschichte. Things are part of Geschichte when things happen to me, and they are understood as God's revelation. There can be a salvation history in the sense of Heil's Geschichte. There cannot be a salvation history in terms of Heil's history. I make the difference. Same. Eh? Both means history. Geschichte means history. History means also history. But history with one particular sense is Geschichte. History with the normal understanding is history. I can't make the distinction in English. Therefore, I use the German words. That's all. Both are history. But then one thing is existential event. It creates in me a perception along with an option. That is the decision with an option. Knowledge with a decision for doing something. Geschichte is that. It is an event that takes place in me. Simply an event that takes place there. That is history. That I am not doing anything. In that case, I am not running up to save anybody or anything. Oh, a car and lorry collided. Okay. History. But car and lorry collided, and one man is there, or somebody is crying, save me, save me. I go immediately, I register my knowledge, and along with my knowledge comes the option to save. I run up. That is an event not merely outside. There is an event that takes place also in me. So that is Geschichte. Other one is simply history. So with regard to, in theology we speak of Heil's Geschichte. Option connected with my option, connected with my decision, existential being. Heil's history, there is no Heil's history. But in English we cannot say there is no salvation history. Salvation history is to be understood in the first sense. In the second sense, there is nothing called a salvation history. I suppose you are able to understand this. Fine distinction. Or I am sure you will come again with questions. And I will explain it at that time. Even though I am repeating, I will not repeat. Only you can learn only by repeatedly hearing the same thing. So, what we want to say about historical revelation is, it is something unconditional and meaningful for my life, and this unconditionality and meaningfulness comes from outside. So in the case of the event of collision between jeep and car, where I hear the sound of help, the unconditionality, whatever I do, I run. The call for help is unconditional. The naked face, he is facing the ego in the domain of selfish domain. He hears the voice, breaks the world of egoistic world, and he hears the cry. That is exactly, you follow the example and the metaphor I used earlier, metaphor Levinas and the naked face. So that's what I'm saying. So I hear that, and for me it is unconditional. The call of that man for help is, I must get away from everything. There is no conditionality. I'll take tea and go. Nothing like that. Or if it is convenient for me, I will do. Nothing like that. Whatever it is, I will run and go and help him. There is an unconditionality. That is part of revelation. And that event is God speaking to me today. God doesn't say, Sebastian, somebody is there, please, under the car, go and help him. God doesn't say that. But God involves in history in this way. The unconditionality of the event is God and the naked face addressing me, and behind the naked face, I see the divine, I, asymmetric relationship. And that is God experience. Okay, I understand the story. In the Bible, there is the statement, God says, go to Ananias, yeah. In the case of Paul. So, in this case here, I said such a thing does not happen, such a thing will not happen, such a thing should not happen. God's telling me is taking place in and through the historical event. And the historical event has got an unconditionality. Then what about God telling Paul? It is a narration of an experience. Paul had an experience in which the other prophet helped him to go forward in his search for understanding Jesus Christ. That is an event. I did not know how historically it took place. But it is communicated to us in this way. When it says, God asked me to go, Paul is saying an internal event. Nobody heard at that time God speaking to Paul. People were there, other people were there. Paul fell down. Nobody saw anything special. Only Paul saw the divine light and the talk. Only Paul experienced. So it is Paul's experience that he writes down in those ways. So don't look at it and question it from the historical report type of question. So it is not to be understood in that sense of history. It is Geschichte. It is not simply history. Geschichte is something that what happened in the mind of Paul. And he felt God is telling him. And so he goes for the prophet and goes behind him. Then everything happens. There is no objection, no contradiction with what I said. God does not tell me, Sebastian, come here and save. God need not say that. That is what I am saying. God inspires me. That event inspires me, that event gives me in that, through that very event, unconditional demand. That unconditional demand, that unconditionality is the transcendent. In that unconditionality, you say, call me, God has inspired me, or God asked me. Very sir. I'm sure you will ask me a question again. I'll tell you, don't worry. So, then historical event is more explicit, more thematic, like in here. More explicit, what I should do, what all things I must prepare. All that is more or less clear, yes.
Another type of history means the events which happens outside.
It does not affect me. It does not speak anything to me directly. History, in the German sense, use the German word history and Geschichte. History in the second sense, an event that is outside of me. Event that is outside of me is not understood in the same way as the Geschichte or the history in the first sense. In the history in the first sense, my knowledge and the commitment. Revelation is connected with these things, knowledge and commitment. My knowledge and option. My knowledge is there, immediately option comes in. They are not two separate movements. At the same moment, I have both. I run. Knowledge as option. That is specific with the revelation.
You said God doesn't intervene in anybody's life.
God intervenes in everybody's life, not in that sense. Not in that sense. God does not intervene like a historical person coming in and disturbing you, calling you, now Kishore, you go to market. God doesn't do that way. But God involves in you. God is taking care of you as part of His people whom He loves. You are also part of God's love, and God is concerned about you. And God is involved in your history. And you have been brought here to the seminary. God is involved in that. God is guiding your history through the whole movement of the church, let us say, and where you see priests working for God's word, and then you felt the call to work for God's word, and you joined the seminary. Well, God is working, God is involved in your history. So don't misunderstand me in that way. I'm very sorry if people were to misunderstand me in that way. God is involved. Yes, good. You ask for clarification, I'll give you. It is a response to a God, to a call from God. They don't themselves convert. It is something that affects them. Swore, for example. Something has affected him. That is a call. It affected his inside. That is his Geschichte, historical event. Geschichtliche event, let us put it this way. God is involved, and that call is the explanation for his conversion. Okay? Any other misunderstandings, please bring it in so that I can clarify it, so that you have a right understanding of things. And don't go with, today, you can bring it any time during the class. Don't go with the wrong understanding of God as thing among things. Don't give the wrong understanding as if God will come and change the rules of nature. Don't go with the understanding. There are some people who believe God breaks the laws of nature. So they believe very proudly about miracles and so on. But then there is no need of positing that type of a God. There is no need. What I said, a God who does not break the laws of nature is good enough and sufficient for us to understand all that happens. And that God is a better God, more perfect than the God who comes in tinkers with the laws of nature every now and then. Okay. So, second aspect of historical revelation is the implications of unconditionality. You have already written that. Emerges not from the existential experience of the believing subject, but reaches him from outside of himself as a message which is proclaimed and makes an appeal. just like the accident there, comes from outside and makes an appeal to me. I go and help him. Then we said also about the language of revelation is the language of disclosure, and that means a knowledge and a commitment. What is disclosure model, specialty of disclosure model language? There is a knowledge as option and a knowledge as option. Knowledge and option. Knowledge of things and option, a commitment. Knowledge and commitment, both are there. That we should be careful to know. What is the element of commitment that is there? In faith, what is the element of commitment? If faith is result of God's self-revelation, there is an element of knowledge and commitment. Do you have that element of commitment? If you do not have that, your faith is not correct. You are behaving like a superstitious man. Knowledge and commitment. Historical revelation includes that. So you can evaluate the faith of the other people. We can evaluate our own faith if there is no commitment to God's kingdom, and we call ourselves Christians. Our calling ourselves Christians is simply meaningless use of words. If you have got a commitment for the kingdom, along with your trust and faith that God will help me and so on, this commitment and knowledge, if it is there, you must develop it, then you are a man of faith. I helping the man there, I am acting my faith, I am doing my faith, helping the man under the lorry. Are you able to get me?
Yes.
That is it. There is this element of commitment and option, and that is specific with the historical revelation. And our revelation, our understanding of revelation is historical. It continues even today. In history, God reveals himself through Christ. So, then we can also, to summarize what we have been seeing before, revelation is not an informing language, but a performing language. Information and performance. It is not informing. It doesn't give you any information about anybody. Doesn't give you any information about when the next meteor is going to reach the earth. I suppose it has already passed. Nothing happened, thank God. But no information will be given to you by revelation. The meteor is coming and it is going to reach the earth. It can be dangerous. God doesn't say that. You have to find that out with your scientific knowledge, with your scientific apparatus. Human beings have to find that out. God has given you the capacity to do that. Use that. Then in that way you can say God is enabling us to understand, or God is telling us, we can understand. But then it is first and foremost through the capacity which God has given. When we use that, God is there. I mean, we can say God is there. Otherwise, God never gives any information. On the contrary, it is not a language of information, or informing language, but performing language. Language, I see here, the example of the lorry car collision and one man underneath and helping, asking for help. In that event, performance, revelation immediately implies performance. I run up and go and help him. Revelation, I spoke also of a symbolic form. I'm a sick man and I show you like this. I am not able to talk. It is a kind of a symbol being used. I am revealing something to you. And that revelation, if you understand, you will immediately come with a cup of water for me. So that knowledge is immediately connected with the action, immediately connected with an option, existential option. So this knowledge, even in this sense, this revelation is not information, but performance. It means that it is never it calls for your action. You come and do that. And that only is the guarantee of faith. Revelation through symbols, historical events can be symbols. Historical events can be symbols. That is what we mean when we say historical events become mythical. Mythical means it is symbol. So historic events become symbolic, and the symbols put together as a story is a myth. So basically it is a symbol. So symbols you understand and you interpret it in terms of performance. You do the action. Then another thing is the whole thing should be consciously symbolic. Revelation is to be understood as a consciously symbolic expression. We should be aware about it. There is need for interpreting. We think of it as a symbol, means that we should interpret it. Symbol. You must interpret it. My symbol. Interpretation. So there must be an interpretation of the symbol. That is to say, ordinary events are somehow mysteriously meaningful. I interpret them as such. The event of that man there under the jeep. Let us take it as a historical event and as a symbol. Every historical event can be understood as a symbol. Symbol means I need to interpret it. When that man is there, somebody is there, I interpret it, all that takes place in a second. I know, I have knowledge, and there is option taking place. The symbol of the man's cry, I hear, that is turned into a performance language revelation. I go and do it. You follow what I am saying? I do it, and only then I can say I have heard the message from the symbol. A symbol is to be interpreted. The reality, ordinary reality, is filled with a deep meaning. If I want to serve Christ, and Christ has said, whatever you do to the least of my brothers, you do it to me, and I do it to that man there, I am encountering Christ. That simple event of somebody asking for help becomes something which speaks to me, becomes something mysteriously meaningful for me, even though I don't think about it at all times, but then in my consciousness that step of interpretation takes place and I go and I help him. So that is one element of revelation, historical revelation. Consciously symbolic and therefore prophetic. God speaking. Prophet speaks for God. So prophetic means speaking for God. So that event, let's take again. God speaking to me. Then I do that. So every historical event becomes symbol of God speaking. So it is symbolic and therefore prophetic. God's call coming in. Yes. Our action, positive action, surely it is response. My implication, it should be authentic. It should lead me to authenticity. Supposing I go there to help him, bring him back to hospital and take him, bring him back to life. My encounter with him enhances his life, and in that enhancement, God's kingdom is being revealed. In that way, kingdom dimension is there in all the encounter of faith. And that is always positive for the person. Positive. If it is negative, I go there, he is my enemy. What shall I do? I go there and put some wrong poison injection. That is not an action. That is not an action of faith. That is not a response.
People don't take initiative like that.
Who? Pardon?
People do not take initiatives like that.
Taking an initiative for doing that is living of faith. People don't want to live faith. It is their business, it is their decision. They have to make an existential decision to be authentic, to save that man's life in the dimension of God's kingdom. A man healthy, now he is a big wound. He becomes healthy, a man, glory of God is man fully alive. That is a statement of one of the first church fathers. Glory of man is man fully alive. That man fully alive, all healthy. I am glorifying God. I'm indicating that God is the king. I'm indicating the kingdom of God, that the element is there. So any involvement that takes place out of faith is always in the direction of the kingdom. It is never for lessening the human being, lessening the life, or on the contrary, enhancing the life experience of the other, always. Then, language unveils an ultimate meaning. I told you, any revelation doesn't give you an objective knowledge, scientific knowledge, but on the contrary, what it gives you is commitment, asking you to do something. So revelation, even where revelation takes the form in history of teaching, law giving, and so on, it does not consist in the information supplied and the new ideas, but in the message they convey, inviting us, gesturing to us, unveiling to us an ultimate meaning. So revelation can be the Ten Commandments. They are a code of law that is being given to us. There, the Ten Commandments as element of knowledge, that is not important. On the contrary, God's invitation to collaborate with Him, God's invitation to obey the law in the giving of the Ten Commandments, that is what is touching, that is what is important, and that is what is part of revelation. In this connection, I would like to say also one more thing. Revelation that takes place in any form will only gradually make the implications explicit. The theoretical implications only gradually becomes explicit. So not at the moment, as I said about in the case of a man in danger, knowledge and option takes place in one moment. The implication of the knowledge is clear in terms of action. That takes place at one moment, it is immediate. But if it is speak of knowledge, then that knowledge element, the knowledge that this man is there, that is knowledge, and my action, option, they both come together. But some other deeper knowledge, it may not be clear at that time, it will come only slowly, slowly. The implication of the event will come realized. Intellectual knowledge, so that can happen. For St. Paul, for example, all his knowledge, all the St. Paul wrote in his letters, is the consequence of his experience of the resurrection. Theoretical knowledge, and the expression of it, the development of this particular knowledge takes time, takes gradually. So God's inspiration and God's involvement in Paul's writing is through this experience of the resurrection. In the resurrection and through the resurrection, other elements become clear to him. So that is, for example. Then in this way, another element, speak about revelation. History becomes theophany. History becomes theophany. Theophany means God becoming visible. History, God manifests himself. Manifestation, theophany. God manifestation. So we can say there is the element of salvation history being realized. In the event, just now the lorry car collision, salvation history for the man under the car, part of his history of salvation involves my action there. So here in the event, for me, God manifests himself. When I do something, I do it for Christ. There is in that way that event is a theophany, demanding from me an action. God is demanding from me, or let us use the Levinasian expression, the naked face. If I forget, I don't go, I will be condemned by the naked face, and I will become murderer. If I go there, I am encountering my righteousness. I go there and do him what is required. So in this way, there is a theophany, history becomes theophany, God's self-manifestation. And there is a salvation history taking place. We can say there is a movement from already now towards not yet, and still further movement when we can say now at last. So already now salvation is. So in the case of the man under the thing, already now, I'm making that a little caricaturing, but then I hope you are able to understand. God's salvation is already realized in history with the coming of Christ. Christ the Savior, and He has brought us salvation. So already now is there, but not yet. There is now and not yet. There is a tension between now and not yet. You know, eschatological tension. You heard that word, eschatological tension? Then you will hear when you learn the Bible. Something called eschatological tension. Tension between now and not yet. Or the already and the not yet. So, already is here and the not yet. Salvation is initially realized and it is not yet fully realized. That moves more forward now at last. At the final moment, everything is that now at last we have reached salvation. So here salvation is there, but the salvation history moves. Salvation history moves. Here salvation is part of history. And we not yet, as long as we are in history, salvation is not yet full. It goes on, and we hope eschatological times, the end of times, the salvation will be fully real. So this movement of already and not yet is there in every historical revelation. Shall I come to this other lowly example? Already now, supposing I go there and take care of the man, he is already somehow saved, but then not yet, not fully. It is yet to be realized. So it has not yet. He goes to the hospital. But even then in the hospital, he is not yet fully saved. He expects and hopes for a full now at last. He hopes. That is salvation. But then salvation is not fully realized even in there when the health is all right. His full salvation is beyond history. So in the end times, finally, realization of. So, this movement can be seen also in this way, in the small little example I showed, spoke to you about. So, there is a hope element coming in, and in this way, there is a relationship with the world coming in. This is a man is here in the world. My relationship with the world, when I take care of the man, I'm related to the world. So in salvation history or in historical revelation, historical theophany, we are turning to the world. God becomes visible, manifests himself in the world. In that man, the naked face, which either condemns me or gives me righteousness. God is visible. The theophany is taking place. And in this theophany, there is element of hope and movement towards the fullness of hope. And this takes place in the world, not apart from the world. The pre-Vatican theology, I do not know how they would have seen, but they would similarly more or less the same. Help the man, charity, and so on. But then that would not be able to explain the whole mystery of the understanding of Revelation. As we now can do. So the whole event becomes for us a model of God's intervention, a model of God's revelation, a model of living of faith. But for the pre-Vatican man, it would not be a model of faith. Because for him, model faith is in the intellectual. Then according to the intellect I want to do, corresponding to that, in that sense, a connection is brought with the charitable act. So in that way, connection is made, connection can be made. But in the In our understanding, there is no connection being made artificially. Faith is option for action, option for saving the man. That is encounter with God and moving towards with hope in the world. It is not, faith is not a question of withdrawal from the world. On the contrary, it is involvement in the world for the transformation of it. The unconditionality I spoke of, the unconditionality is the result of this. The world, the ordinary temporal world becomes a factor with an unconditionality. The event becomes unconditional, result to be. Then another important thing with regard to this kind of revelation is the role of tradition. Check again. I don't remember now in the order. I will not put it down. One more piece of the layers. The bearer of the message, that is, there are different facts from that fact, action, words, persons, events, all are situated in history. The man under the jeep, under the accident place. They are unique and they are not going to be repeated. This event, for example, something happened. It is unique. It is not going to happen again in the same way with the same man and the same consequence. Unique events taking place in history. Unique and never to be repeated. In their unicity, they belong to the past. The event after it is over, it belongs to the past. If the gesture of invitation which the message constitutes is to remain real in history, it must be unceasingly re-actualized by being interpreted in faith. So the event is over. And if the event should be speaking to me continuously, but the event is unique, unicity. The unicity or of the event are speaking to me always. It can happen, it can speak to me always if I interpret it. The event in the past, I can interpret it in the sense of God talking to me at any time in the future, any time after. I remember the event that happened there in front of Brindisi Bhavan, happened and we ran together and saved the man. And that event I can recall at any time afterwards also. I can interpret it. So there God asked me, I'm interpreting after some 10 days ago. God asked me, God revealed to me His word and I responded to His word. And that is an event of encounter with God, is an event of experience of faith and revelation. I must interpret it later on so that it becomes also meaningful afterwards. Otherwise, the event is unique and unicity, it belongs to the past. If the gesture of invitation which the message constitutes is to remain real in history, it must be unceasingly re-actualized by being interpreted in faith. In this concept of tradition, the accent shifts from traditum, what is passed on, to the actus tradendi, the act of passing on. So, I'm speaking about tradition. What is tradition? An event that took place, or different events that took place in the past, is not left in its unicity, in its uniqueness in the past. That event is being reflected upon afterwards, and interpreted and communicated. So the events of, let us say, what tradition. Tradition is a number of these kind of events which are being communicated in the present and it will be communicated also in the future. Christian tradition, if you want to say. We belong to the Christian tradition. That means the death and resurrection of Jesus. The fact that Jesus, in Jesus, God came into the world. And that He lived for us and say about the work of salvation, died and rose again. That event is a unique event. It will never be repeated. Even when we celebrate in the Eucharist, the event of salvation is not repeated. Some people used to say the Calvary Bali is being repeated. It is not true. Event of Calvary is only once. There is a unicity, it belongs to the past. It is not being repeated. Remembered. We will come to that when we speak about the Eucharist. So it is not repeated. That is what is important for us to know. Event is one there, and that event is brought later on after 2000 years into our memory, and we are interpreting and understanding the event. Then so many other things also are there connected with that. The apostles coming together, they forming a church and making all different kinds of commandments and laws, and all practice of the church is being defined, and it goes on. So all these things are being carried over, and we are part of this flow of the past events being remembered. So in this we find ourselves in tradition. Tradition means this: the past not remaining a past, but the past is coming to us in the present and making impact upon us. So the importance here, what in my description, the content of the tradition is not given that importance as the fact of tradition, the fact of handing over. Tradition means handing over. Dire means give. Dition, that's the word. Tradition, give over. So the fact of handing over of the past takes place, and we become part of the tradition. What is being handed over, that I am not explaining very much now. The important thing is, tradition is a handing over of the past events and its impact towards the present. It is only through the act of passing on the kerygma with one and the same faith that the facts of the past preserve their revealing function. You understand kerygma, preaching. In preaching, the apostles described the events that took place, and the kerygma is continually done. Preaching is continually done, and the event is being interpreted and repeated for us. So kerygma is necessary and part of the tradition. Kerygma within one and the same faith. So it is through this kerygma, the facts of the past preserve their revealing function. They are handed over from generation to generation and celebrated. And through this generation, they revive the actuality of the event. So the event of Jesus' death and resurrection, it is handed over from generation to generation. And in this handing over, the reality of the event is preserved as a reality that affects you and encounters you as a sign. So they are handed over and commemorated from generation to generation to revive the actuality of the meaning of the events through remembrance and sign. So tradition means simply this: a continuous rethinking and reliving from the past. Tradition is simply this: a continuous rethinking and reliving of the passage from the past. Historical revelation is based on this kind of a handing over from generation to generation, this kind of a movement from generation to generation. So this is where we are. We are in the Christian tradition.